Order. I ask all present to please rise, and on this Flag Day, join with me as we recite the Pledge of Allegiance to our flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. In the absence of clergy, I ask all present to please bow your heads in a moment of silent prayer and or reflection. The reading of the journal.
In Senate Wednesday, June 13th, the Senate met pursuant to adjournment. The journal of Tuesday, June 12th, was read and approved on motion. Senate adjourned.
Is read. Presentation of petitions, messages from the Assembly. The Secretary will read.
On page 58, Senator Bonasek moved to discharge the Committee on Rules, Assembly Bill number 10365, and substituted for the identical Senate Bill 8324, third reading calendar 1325. On page 61, Senator DeFrancisco moved to discharge from the Committee on Finance, Assembly Bill number 8156, and substitute for the identical Senate Bill 6452, third reading calendar 1371.
Substitutions are so ordered. Messages from the Governor, reports of standing committees, reports of select committees, communications and reports of state officers, motions and resolutions. Senator DeFrancisco.
I'd like to call up Senator LaValle's bill, print 6353, recall from the Assembly, which is now at the desk.
Secretary will read.
Calendar number 1264 by Senator LaValle, Senate print 6353, enact amending environmental conservation law.
I now move to reconsider the vote by which the bill was passed.
Call roll reconsideration.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Jung, ayes 50.
Now offer the following amendments.
The amendments are received.
On page 62, I offer the following amendments to calendar 1387, Senate print 7940A by Senator Seward, and ask that this bill retain its place on the third reading calendar.
The amendments are received. The bill shall retain its place on third reading.
On page 50, I offer the following amendments to calendar 1219, Senate print 692C by Senator Ort, and ask that said bill retain its place on a third reading calendar.
Amendments are received and the bill shall retain its place on third reading.
On page 55, we're off the following amendments to calendar 1291, Senate print 7262 by Senator Murphy, and ask that said bill retain its place on the third reading calendar.
The amendments are received and the bill shall retain its place on third reading.
We have a resolution.
Please recognize Senator Klein.
Senator Klein.
Mr. President, on behalf of myself, on page 9, I offer the following amendments to calendar number 214. Senate print number 6953, and as it said, bill retain its place on third reading calendar.
The amendments are received, and the bill shall retain its place on third reading. Senator DeFrancisco?
Yes, I'd like to move to adopt the resolution calendar with no exceptions.
All in favor of adopting the resolution calendar indicate by saying aye. Opposed? The resolution calendar has been adopted. Senator DeFrancisco?
Now, can we take up previously adopted resolution 5669 by Senator Persaud, title only, and call on Senator Larkin to speak.
Secretary will read.
Legislative resolution number 5669 by Senator Persaud, commemorating June 14, 2018 as Flag Day.
Senator Larkin.
Thank you, Mr. President. Flag Day, huh? How many flags did we see on stores and members? Knowing that this is a long, long line. It started years and years ago. At first, it didn't go much until President Woodrow Wilson made a specific day. And then later on, the date was changed and made it a permanent date by Senator President Truman in 1949 at June the 14th. Would be the date, Flag Day, of the state of the United States of America. This flag represents not just a flag. And I know that some of you don't embrace the tone of what it means. Every military station today, you will see the troops getting up at 5 o'clock, going out and doing physical fitness, and then taking a stand of reveille. Reveille meaning get up and get moving. And then these troops take the first time out and salute the flag. Proudly defending you and I. This flag is not just a piece of material. It is something in our nation that says this is us, the United States of America. And if you don't like it, go to hell. Because there's a lot of us that have spent time in combat so that you can have a negative attitude. The flag of the United States of America. Thank God we have it. Thank God for those who respect it. And thank God who've given their lives in service of this type. Thank you very much, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Larkin. Senator DeFrancisco.
I'd just like to point out something that happened the last couple of days relevant to this. Senator Larkin not only talks the talk, he walks the walk. I was here yesterday. I didn't have a lapel pin with a flag on it. And he said to me, you better have a flag pin on tomorrow. And guess what? The first thing I saw him this morning, I didn't have a flag pin on. And he pulls one out of his pocket. And I've got it. And I'm wearing it. And the only reason I mention it is not only to show the true nature of Senator Larkin, but also to indicate that I'm a veteran. And I served during the Vietnam War era. I didn't go to combat, thank God. And I still forget doing it. And I still don't do what I should do to provide honor for the flag that so many people fought for representing our country. So thank you, Senator Prasad, for the resolution. It's an important one. Thank you, Senator Larkin, for your constant reminders on and off the Senate floor of how important our military, our flag, and our country is, are to all of us. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator DeFrancisco. As indicated, the resolution has been previously adopted on June 12th. It is open for co-sponsorship. If you choose to be a co-sponsor, please notify the desk. Senator DeFrancisco.
Senator Flanagan making committee assignments. Do you have that?
The hand up is received and will be filed in the journal.
Thank you. At this point, can we? I'd like to call an immediate meeting of the Rules Committee in room 332.
There's an immediate meeting of the Rules Committee in room 332. The Senate will stand at ease. Senate will return to order. Senator DeFrancisco.
I understand there's a report of the Rules Committee at the desk.
There is a Rules Committee report at the desk, and the Secretary will read.
Senator Flanagan from the Committee on Rules reports the following bills. Senate Print 1330A by Senator Valesky, enact amendment to state finance law. Senate 1862A by Senator Golan, enact amendment to civil service law. Senate 2412D by Senator DeFrancisco, enact amendment to judiciary law. Senate 2538A by Senator Griffo, enact amendment to vehicle and traffic law. Senate 3502 by Senator DeFrancisco, enact amendment to state law. Senate 3541 by Senator Lanza, enact amendment to public health law. Senate 3644 by Senator Parker, enact amendment to public service law. Senate 5489B by Senator Parker, enact amendment to tax law. Senate 5631B by Senator DeFrancisco, enact amendment to vehicle and traffic law. Senate 6274 by Senator Lanza. Enact amendment Chapter 154 of the laws of 1921. Senate 6475.
Can I have some order, please? Secretary will continue.
Senate 6475A by Senator O'Mara, enact to direct. Senate 6622A by Senator Ranzenhofer, enact amendment to general municipal law. Senate 6666 by Senator Amador, enact amendment to workers' compensation law. Senate 7018 by Senator Prasad, enact amendment to public service law. Senate 7397A by Senator Ranzenhofer, an act to amend the tax law. Senate 7561A by Senator O'Meara, an act to amend the tax law. Senate 7815 by Senator Ranzenhofer, an act to amend the tax law. Senate 7965 by Senator Breslin, an act to amend Chapter 454 of the laws of 2010. Senate 7990 by Senator Carlucci, an act to amend the real property tax law. Senate 8127 by Senator Kaminsky, an act authorizing. Senate 8193 by Senator Addabbo, an act to amend the environmental conservation law. Senate 8560A by Senator Murphy, an act to amend the alcoholic beverage control law. Senate 8639C by Senator Lavelle, an act to amend the education law. Senate 8749 by Senator Sepulveda, an act to amend the education law. Senate 8769 by Senator Orr, an act to amend the mental hygiene law. Senate 8823 by Senator Felder, an act to amend the education law. Senate 8830 by Senator Seward, an act to amend the agriculture markets law. And Senate 8955 by Senator Orr, an act to amend the public health law. All bills reported direct to third reading.
All in favor of accepting the Committee on Rules report, signify by saying aye. Aye. Opposed? The Rules Committee is accepted and before the House. Senator DeFrancisco.
We now go to messages from the Assembly.
We will return to messages from the Assembly, and the Secretary will read.
Senator Valesky moved to discharge the Committee on Finance Assembly Bill Number 7819A and substituted for the identical Senate Bill 1338, third reading calendar 1781. Senator Parker moved to discharge the Committee on Energy and Telecommunications Assembly Bill Number 2451 and substitute for the identical Senate Bill 3644, third reading calendar 1787. Senator Parker moved to discharge the Committee on Investigations and Government Operations Assembly Bill Number 2788B and substitute for the identical Senate Bill 5489B, third reading calendar 1788. Senator Lanza moved to discharge the Committee on Corporations and Authorities Assembly Bill Number 6991 is substituted for the identical Senate Bill 6274, third reading calendar 1790. Senator Breslin moves a discharge from the Committee on Rules, Assembly Bill Number 10058, and substituted for the identical Senate Bill 7965, third reading calendar 1798. Senator Carlucci moved a discharge from Committee on Local Government, Assembly Bill Number 9729. And substituted for the identical Senate Bill 7990, third reading calendar 1799. Senator Sepulveda moved to discharge from Committee on Education, Assembly Bill Number 381, and substituted for the identical Senate Bill 8749, third reading calendar 1804. And Senator Ort moved to discharge from Committee on Rules, Assembly Bill Number 9868, and substituted the identical Senate Bill 8955, third reading calendar 1808.
Substitutions are so ordered. Senator DeFrancisco.
Yes, can we go back to motions and resolutions, please?
We will return to motions and resolutions. Senator DeFrancisco.
On page 41, I offer the following amendments to calendar 1009, Senate print 8229 by Senator Lanza, and ask that said bill retain its place on the third reading calendar.
The amendments are received. The bill shall retain its place on third reading.
Mr. President, in addition to the active list of today, we now have a supplemental calendar that 55A that is comprised of the bills that were just came from the Senate Rules Committee. I'd request off of that calendar that you call up 1783 for action.
Senate will operate from Senate Supplemental Calendar 55A. And the Secretary will read the request of the floor leader.
Calendar number 1783 by Senator DeFrancisco, Senate print 2412D.
Lay it aside.
Take up the controversial reading, please.
Secretary will ring the bell. And the Secretary will read.
Calendar number 1783 by Senator DeFrancisco, Senate print 2412D, an act amended judiciary law.
Senator Kaminsky.
Will the sponsor yield?
Senator DeFrancisco, do you yield?
Yes, I will.
Will the sponsor please give an explanation and explain why he's calling this first as part of that explanation?
An explanation of what?
Could you explain that? Say that again, I'm sorry. Could I just have some a little more quiet in the House. I know there are a lot of visitors and staff moving around, so the members can hear each other. Senator Kaminsky, could you please repeat?
Through you, Mr. President, I request the sponsor explain what this bill would do and include as part of that explanation why he called it first among all the other bills today.
I called it first among all the bills today because it's the most important bill on the calendar that I've been working on for year after year after year. And I've had the opportunity to get this bill on the calendar. This is the first time. And it's such an important bill that I think on a getaway day, it's important that as many people be here as possible to make a vote on it. The bill itself is a bill that is modeled after the Judicial Conduct Commission. And basically, what it does is it gives the general public the opportunity to make a complaint of what they may believe is prosecutorial misconduct to review by an independent body to determine whether any consequences, if proven, should be imposed as a result of misconduct, and conversely, to exonerate anybody from any potential allegations of misconduct. And that's exactly what the Judicial Conduct Commission does. The Judicial Conduct Commission was started in the 1970s. And I remember right now there's such an outcry by prosecutors that the world is going to come to an end, that they should not be reviewed, that they are always ethical and forthright, and that this is going to interfere with the operation of their business. Exactly what the judges said in the 1970s. And what's happened with this independent body is that people can get an independent review if the judge is guilty of misconduct. Recently, there was a judge that was removed or recommended to be removed in Rochester. But by and large, most every one of these allegations end up in no action. So they're exonerated many, many more times than any kind of action is being requested. So this would provide that same process. Why is it needed? Well, I'm sure someone in my office is going to bring me down specific examples. And those specific examples, I'll give you general examples. There's many cases where individuals are convicted of crimes as heinous as murder and spend 10, 20 years in jail and are found later, and they were found later because of DNA evidence, that they weren't the guilty party. So then they go to the state of New York and the Court of Claims bring a lawsuit, and the state and our taxpayers have to pay millions of dollars for that misconduct. Usually it's withholding exculpatory information that would help the defense, and by law they're supposed to provide that. Now, 99% of the prosecutors are good prosecutors and would not do these types of things. I felt I was a good assistant DA when I was doing this in Syracuse, New York. But it's the outliers that there ought to be an ability to at least make a complaint, have it reviewed, and determine under the same process as the Judicial Conduct Bill.
Will the sponsor continue to yield?
Sponsor to yield?
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
Would defendants be able to bring claims before the tribunal during a pending case, meaning before it has concluded?
You could bring, there's no time limit as far as when somebody can bring a complaint. However, every part of the Prosecutorial Conduct Commission's interactions or workings is confidential, including all documents that would have to be reviewed. So anything that would gone before the commission would be subject to confidentiality.
Will the sponsor continue to you?
Sponsor yes. Yields.
Is there any empirical evidence that there's been an uptick in prosecutorial misconduct findings by the appellate courts or any other body that you've seen in recent years?
Well, let me tell you about just the last week and a half. Because two of those instances came up very recently. One happened to be in federal court, Manhattan. that you probably read about. And in that situation, there was a murder trial going on. And the murder trial was going on, and days before the trial, the prosecutor provided exculpatory material in the form of a confession to the judge. The judge went apoplectic, saying, "Why are you providing this information now to us?" Now, obviously, our bill would not apply to federal prosecutors, but this bill does not apply to the Attorney General. And the reason it doesn't, the Assembly wanted it out for me to get a same-as bill. So I took it out. But just within the last week and a half, the DA in Rensselaer County, it was found out that the prosecutor in that case did not have the authority to bring the charges. And I would think that that would be at least questionable, or at least be arguably misconduct, that you're prosecuting someone, going through the whole process, when you don't even have jurisdiction to handle the case. Just right in the nick of time, they heard me over the loudspeaker. By state, in Texas, number of exonerations, 326, New York, 233, Illinois, 197. We go all the way down to the smaller states. They happen all the time. If you came to a news conference that I had maybe 2 months ago, you could have met one of the exonerees who spent over 20 years in jail. And we've had many of them come to news conferences over the last 3 or 4 years. And you know what happened to the prosecutor in every one of those cases? Nothing. Nothing. Not even a bad news article in most cases. That's wrong.
Continue to yield?
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
The question I asked was, is there any empirical evidence, not anecdotal evidence, of an uptick in prosecutorial misconduct? I understand there are exonerations. They could come for lots of reasons. But is there been an increase in prosecutorial misconduct findings in recent years?
Yes, there's been an increase as soon as, it depends on what you mean by recently. Ever since the rules for DNA evidence were broadened, probably 10 years ago, when evidence was being provided that these individuals who were in jail were not the individual that was guilty of the charges. From that point forward, various groups bringing lawsuits thereafter on behalf of the wrongfully incarcerated person were able to determine through review of evidence that there were withholding of evidence by prosecutors. So yes, the uptick has come after the DNA rules were broadened to provide more DNA samples upon arrest for certain offenses. Yes, and whether there's an uptick or not, this has been happening without consequence. And every single person should be subject to consequences and responsibility for their actions.
Will the sponsor continue to you?
Yes.
Is the sponsor aware that the New York State Bar Association's Task Force on Wrongful Convictions found 53 cases from 1964 to 2009, and that is 0.004 of 1% of all convictions?
That I don't know that for a fact, but it would not surprise me. The prosecutors also told me that they are being reviewed, and there's plenty of punishment on the books. There's plenty of oversight on the books because they're subject to going before the grievance committees in each county. If anybody knows of a case where a prosecutor actually went before a grievance committee and anything happened, I'll give you $10, okay? I asked the prosecutors that 3 years ago. You say there's a sufficient remedy? There's a sufficient remedy? Give me one case. And what, you know what they told me? They said, we'll bring up tons of cases. Last year, nada. This year, nada. In addition, there was a prosecutor in Senator Richie's district, St. Lawrence County. I won't even go into all the stuff she did. She ultimately decided not to run again. But the fact of the matter is, they said, I'll show you how good we are. We're going to bring a case before the grievance committee against this prosecutor. That was 2 years ago. Last year, I asked them, what's the status of your grievance? Well, we haven't heard anything yet. I mean, that's what happens. There's no accountability. I'm not out to get anybody, and I'm certainly not considered soft on crime as far as philosophy. I'm just trying to get a process that's fair to everybody involved in that process. So anybody could get statistics for anything they want, and if anybody doesn't realize that in this chambers, they probably shouldn't be in this chambers. And especially if you're the individuals who are fighting the bill that to provide evidence that support you.
Will the sponsor continue to yield?
Yes.
Can the sponsor tell us why he believes that there'll be more open and more reporting to his tribunal than to the grievance commission?
Absolutely. You know why? You certainly are familiar with grievance committees in each county. They're lawyers from that county. Do you know lawyers from the county sometimes have criminal cases? Who do they have to go to when they're plea bargaining? Do you think for 1 minute that any lawyer is going to go to provide a grievance against the DA that he believes he's going to have to go to and try to get a deal for a client? Because sometimes miscarriage of justice can happen, and there's plea bargains. Think of, I don't know who the hell your DA is, but think of going before your DA and saying that these are the merits. There should be a reduction in charge after you're on a grievance committee and you found that that he has been guilty of something or she has been guilty of something. That's why this is an independent body. Two Senate majority, one Senate minority pick. Two, same with the assembly, two for the governor, and I think three for the chief judge.
Sponsor continue to yield?
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
I mean, the sponsor, I'm sure, is aware that the complaints against prosecutors aren't about the DA. They're about assistant DAs, and they happen every single day. They happen in every motion, in every habeas corpus petition, in every, I mean, prosmis is a routine appellate argument. I don't understand why it's seen as the third rail. Why aren't we trying to improve the grievance process as opposed to creating a whole new political tribunal?
You've talked to the prosecutors, and they have taught you well. Because they told me that same thing. They said it works terrifically. That's exactly why I asked them to give me examples. They provided none, and they even provided a perfect example for me why what my view is probably correct, and that is they brought a grievance against one of their own, and she decided not to run 2 years later, and no determination on the grievance was ever made.
Will the sponsor continue to yield?
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
The sponsor agrees that before the judicial misconduct panel was created, there was no means by which to discipline judges. There was no grievance panel for them. So this was created as a means to do that?
And on paper, correct. But in practice, there's no other way to the prosecutors can reasonably be reviewed because the grievance committee never does it and hasn't done it. You know, I just want to interject one thing. We're not talking about cases where people are given a traffic ticket and then paying a fine. People have stayed in jail for years. The courts, the state has paid and the taxpayer paid millions and millions of dollars because of prosecutorial misconduct, and there's no consequence for that person. That's wrong. And we're not, as I said, check with the records on the Judicial Conduct Commission. 95% of the judges are exonerated. But what it did, when judges used to call people names, lawyers' names, or racial epithet, that's against clients when they were on the bench because they could do any damn thing they want. They changed. They knew somebody is up there looking and watching and could complain, and there could be consequences. You don't see that stuff as much anymore. It used to be commonplace because I was there back then.
Will the sponsor continue to yield?
Yes.
Why is this not a vehicle that every defendant will use to tie an office up into knots, even in the middle of pending cases? Who would not avail themselves of making such an application?
I agree with you 1,000%, that at the beginning, there's going to be a flood of different complaints made. There's no doubt. That was the same thing with the judges. But over time, if you have independent people and it turns out to result in no action because they were false claims or just not proven claims, that in the long run, and I don't mean 10 years from now, I mean in the relatively recent future, that's going to go down just like it did with the Judicial Conduct Commission as well. And besides, if there is a flood of complaints originally, I'd rather have a flood of complaints and 11 people on a board that we appoint sift through those claims than someone not have a remedy against somebody who has thrown somebody in jail and withheld evidence.
Will the sponsor continue to yield?
As long as you want.
Sponsor yields.
Has the sponsor been in favor or co-sponsored or been part of any effort to push discovery reform so greater access to evidence is given earlier on in the criminal justice process?
Yes, I have. I've worked with Assemblyman Lentol. I've been involved that. No doubt about it, I have been. Sure I have. But what good is it if the prosecutor's not going to give you the information?
On the bill.
Senator Kaminsky on the bill.
I'm very troubled by this bill, and everyone in here should be too. We have problems in our criminal justice system, but when the medicine kills the patient, we've kind of lost track of where we are. So I'm going to tell you what's going to happen in every prosecutor's office throughout our state. First of all, we're taking a process that's supposed to be apolitical and making it very political. I'll give you an example. Prosecutors all the time have to make heart-wrenching decisions about what to do with car crashes where people die. Sometimes people drive in an unsafe manner. They'll look at the radio. They'll be lighting a cigarette. They'll be doing something else. And they'll run somebody over, God forbid. Prosecutors have to make really tough decisions about whether that is vehicular manslaughter or whether it's not worthy of the criminal justice case. What will every family do when a decision is made that manslaughter shouldn't be charged? They're going to bring a prosecutor in front of this panel and say, this is misconduct. I want this defendant charged for what they did to my family. And so when you're a prosecutor now evaluating what to do, whether to do justice, which is the only directive, you are now going to say, well, I got this panel I got to go in front of. I know that Senator so-and-so appointed this person who doesn't really like, you know, they want to look good on this issue. So now we're going to start charging a couple of vehicular manslaughters to keep us safe. Right? That's not what we want to do. And what about political corruption now that we've had a political panel overseeing DAs? First of all, welcome to Planet Albany. How many people have been indicted since, let's say, 2008 in the last 10 years? And our answer is to handcuff prosecutors? That's the reform? So we do pension forfeiture and a prosecutor tribunal. It's like crazy. And no prosecutor is going to want to bring a political corruption case when they know that a senator or a assembly person or someone from the executive chamber is going to get hauled in front of a court and then in front of a panel of somebody they appointed or from their conference appointed. We're really politicizing an area. But most importantly, we're going to tie an office in knots. So let me tell you what really happens in the real world. In the real world, you convict somebody. Then they appeal. After that, they could appeal the appellate court. And after that, they could take a collateral appeal to federal court through a habeas corpus petition. There is review upon review upon review. And everybody claims it. That's what makes this hard. Everybody says I was wrongfully convicted. Everyone says my lawyer was inadequate. Everyone says evidence was planted. Everyone says I have a confession on this tape here you have to listen to that their friend made and sent them to prison. It's really hard sifting through this stuff. And we do it a lot already. Not we, they do it a lot already. So what's going to happen when we have a prosecutor misconduct panel that operates in pending cases? I get arrested. Misconduct. This person I like got arrested. Misconduct. You're not going to be able to do an investigation anymore. And if it is called after the fact, it will tie an office up in knots talking about what happened yesterday and yesterday and yesterday. So how do we get at the injustices that occur that Senator DeFrancisco rightly points out to undermine confidence in our criminal justice system? It's called discovery reform. It's called bail reform. It's called speedy trial reform, none of which this House has wanted to do. And how about we tell defendants in court there's this thing called the grievance process. You could write to it pro se, just like you wrote the U.S. Attorney's Office or the DA's Office a letter with a pencil talking about all these claims that now they have to answer. Do one to them, too. Do one to the grievance panel. We should be pumping that up. There is a vehicle. There is an avenue that already exists to get at bad prosecutors. It should be used much more. And bad prosecutors should be held accountable not only by judges, which they are all the time. The amount of times a judge will throw out evidence, will throw a case on its head, will bounce a case out of court because they see misconduct happens every day. It's just not reported. There's no statistic to keep it. But in those cases, we should be telling defendants if there is misconduct, go to the grievance panel that already exists. The judicial panel was created because you couldn't do that. The judge couldn't go in front of the grievance committee. So to model this after that just is inept. It doesn't make sense. At the end of the day, our prosecutors are the people who at night are up working, keeping all of us safe. I can't tell you the amount of nights where I left the office at 11, 12 at night and people were still there working on wiretap applications, figuring out how to take down organized crime, figuring out how to get people who are ripping off the public, and we are now going to put one hand tied behind their back because the medicine kills the patient. So we could do a lot more to get at these acts. This is not the answer. And frankly, for an Albany that's been less than responsive on political corruption, this I just think is just unseemly, right? We're going to add on top of the prosecutors who are supposed to be policing politicians a political level of appointees to oversee them. How's that work? Forget about the fact that in court this will have all types of separation of powers issues about a governor appointing people to tell a prosecutor whether he or she can stay in office or not, or to review or to send a recommendation that he or she be removed from office, which, by the way, voters are supposed to do every 4 years. So this bill is fraught with a lot of issues, and at the end of the day, we here have to be having our prosecutors' backs, making them do more, making them be accountability, but to weigh down the office completely, I just really don't think makes sense. And for those of you, and I see certain senators standing up who are big fans of police departments, who support law enforcement, come on, what's going to happen here? For those of us who stand with police officers, every case where someone says misconduct, who's going to get called first? Police officer Smith's going to get called in. Is it true that you executed a warrant that this prosecutor gave where you kicked this person's door down and did X, Y, and Z? We're going to create a whole level of testimony for police officers. And what does that mean? Well, when an officer testifies, you got to give their whole record. All right, now we got their whole record in play, and now we're cross-examining a police officer about something they did 4 years before. This is not good for law enforcement. This is not good for prosecutors. At the end of the day, it doesn't get at what we're trying to do. I'm all for real criminal justice reform. I really believe we could do that. I think the time is ripe for that. But the time to put a concrete boot on a prosecutor is not now. We need them more than ever working on terrorism cases, working on political corruption cases, and doing what's right in our society. So I'd urge my colleagues to really, really think about this. I know there are mixed feelings across the aisle on this, but at the end of the day, I really believe we can do better. I would just say to the sponsor, I certainly get where the sponsor's coming from, but I also just want to finish by saying one thing. I think there's been a lot of feelings about federal prosecutors who some in this building may think have gone out of their lane to make cases that they believe should not have been made. This has got nothing to do with that. This doesn't come to federal prosecutors. It's got nothing to do with the Southern District of New York. It's got nothing to do with anyone who may have been prosecuted here or anywhere else. This is about something different. We should all be careful before we put this in a law and add a real change to our criminal justice system that could have very deleterious effects. Thank you.
Senator Sanders.
years. In my hand, I hold the National Registry of Exonerations. The amount of years that people spent in jail and were exonerated that we know about. 19,610 years. In New York State, 249 people. I could read the names. The majority of these, black and Latino. I see some from my own borough. Justice delayed is justice denied. It is important that we have safeguards in any system. Now, some may say that there are enough safeguards, but it's also a fact that poverty ensures conviction. Just about. If you don't have the money to ensure that you have an adequate defense, then 10 to 1, you are going up. Let's imagine that the sponsor is not perfect. Imagine that. Let's imagine that the bill is not perfect. Imagine that. My friends, we need to think more about the years that people can't get back. How can I look in the face of a mother and tell her I was more worried about how I would look politically, that the bill didn't come from my party, so I couldn't really do anything about it. How am I going to look in the face of a child wondering about their father or daughter or mother and say that politically it wasn't the right season, that I personally should have set that down and we couldn't do anything? Nah, you got the wrong man here. These names mean something to me. These are as citizens of this country as worthy as anybody else. 19,000 years that they're not going, no amount of money is going to give you that back. They would trade that money in a heartbeat. Do we need to do something about this? Absolutely. Is this the thing to do? We can argue that. I wish someone gave me the perfect bill that I was looking for. I don't think that, you know, that perfection exists ever since the apple was bitten. But with that being said, we have to do something. Somebody has to stand up for these folk and say, you know what? Right is right. And it's not right Republican or right Democrat. It's not right of any of those things. There's certain things that are just right. And if we can stand for those things, we'll get above this. Yes, we, as a reformer, I want there to be strong prosecutors. And I think that there is a role for them. And we should not shackle them, handcuff them, or any of those things. We should not. We should make sure that the system is as fair as we possibly can make it. And we should do everything in our power to make sure that that part of society, that the prosecutor plays an incredibly important part. We have to make sure that they are safe, that their very important mission is protected. But let us not say that we're not going to do these things because we'll somewhere, somebody would say that we look bad. Let us not say that we're going to allow somebody to, even as we speak, there are innocent people in jail and somebody should speak for them. And if there's a process or prosecutors, you know, after a while we know the bad apples in the system. After a while, we know that there's a problem. And until the system itself polices itself, until people stand up and say, you know what, I will have no part of this, we know that that guy is messed up, then we need to do something on this issue. And I'm glad that that the sponsor in his swan song has brought an important issue to the fore. Whatever comes from this, he has done a service to the people of New York State and should be proud of that. So under those conditions, I'm going to listen to the rest of this debate, but if the only thing that we can say is how we'll look bad or it came from this party or that party, then I'm going to go with this unless I hear a more pressing reason of why we shouldn't look for how we're going to attack this issue. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Sanders. Senator Bailey.
Thank you, Mr. President. So this is a very important issue, a very important bill, and I appreciate the dialogue being what it is, regardless of outcome. Senator DeFrancisco, in your debate, you mentioned a phrase, tongue-in-cheek almost, the world's not going to come to an end. And I agree with you, if we do this, the world won't come to an end. The world didn't come to an end in New York City when stop and frisk was taken away, when they said, if you stop and frisk, the old bad New York is going to come back. Crime is at a record low. I want us to make sure that we're looking clearly through the lens of objectivity and not a partisan lens. Every prosecutor is not going to be Andrew Lanza or Todd Kominsky. 99% of them are, but I want my folks on both sides of the aisle to understand that perfection does not exist. There are bad prosecutors, bad attorneys, bad police officers, bad elected officials. We have to have a mechanism to figure out what's right and what's fair. And partisanship aside, if we're talking about fairness, it comes back to discovery. It comes back to bail, and it comes back to speedy trial. And I hope that if we have this attitude today that we're going to do something, which is a step in the right direction on these matters, that we have time in this session to do something about discovery reform. It passed the Assembly. 4368, Assemblyman Lentol, who Senator DeFrancisco indicated properly that he's been working with, that passed the Assembly. We have a chance to do something on that in this House this year. Why wait? If this is on the calendar, if this is on the rules agenda, if this is on the floor, there is no reason why that bill should not come to the floor as well. Because we're trying to cure the root issue. You pull a leaf off a plant, the leaf can go to grow back. If we have a problem, you've got to pull it out by the root. And the root is figuring out what's right and what's fair. I don't want a defense attorney to have an advantage. I don't want a prosecutor to have an advantage. I want fairness. And I've said this often in discussions with district attorneys and folks on the Republican side of the aisle about why I support discovery reform. It's a public safety issue. I have a wife and two small children. Nobody wants public safety more than I do. But as an attorney, duly admitted to the bar of the state of New York, I want fairness for everyone. And I want, if you've been unfairly accused of a crime, that you have an ability to redress these complaints. The Assembly has also passed grand jury reform. Also something that we can do this year. So if we're in this attitude about making change, about making sure we're doing what's right, let's not limit ourselves. We talked about exculpatory evidence, and I'm glad that that was mentioned. We have no definition of what exculpatory is. Sometimes a prosecutor can define their own version of exculpatory evidence, which is the reason why we need discovery reform. And Senator Lanza can attest to this. We've peacefully disagreed in the Codes Committee the entire year about the idea of discretion and about how we take judges' discretion away when it's time for certain crimes, but it's okay for them to have discretion when it comes to bail reform and discovery reform. Discretion cannot be discretionary. Let us be very clear on that.
Bailey, I'd like to keep it to the bill before the House, please.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you.
Yes, Mr. President, I believe that my comments were and are germane because they do relate to criminal justice as a whole, which the prosecutors in the state of New York do uphold, but I will respect what you're saying and go back on the bill in chief. It is important to recognize misconduct. Statistics show it, as Senator Sanders indicated, but stats don't always tell the truth. The number of cases that we have about the misconduct or the reported cases do not accurately tell the whole story about what happens in communities like mine, about stories that I've heard, about phone calls that I've personally received. So, Mr. President, much like my colleague Senator Sanders, I want to hear what else other folks have to say, but I understand that there is a season for this type of legislation, and I hope that we have that attitude towards similar legislation in the remaining time that we have to do what's right. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Bailey. Senator Lanza.
Thank you, Mr. President. On the bill. First, Mr. President, I'd like to associate myself with every word of Senator Sanders' remarks, which were, as always, incredibly thoughtful. So, too, I would like to thank Senator Bailey for the comment, for the compliment, which I pray I can live up to. In some respects, this is a very sad day. As a former prosecutor, I never dreamt that I would ever stand in support of legislation like this, because I never wished to believe that legislation like this would be necessary. You see, I was a prosecutor in the Manhattan District Attorney's Office. I worked for Robert Morgenthau, who I continue to believe is the gold standard for prosecutors. But I've become increasingly troubled over the years since then that they just don't make them like Robert Morgenthau anymore. And I listened to my colleague, Senator Kaminsky, who I have tremendous respect for, also a former prosecutor. And as Senator Bailey said, if everyone treated the work the way I'm sure Senator Kaminsky did, as I know him, we would not even need to discuss this legislation. And I think Senator Kaminsky's mistake is that he believes that everyone does it the right way. And the truth of the matter is, 99% of the prosecutors in this state do. Senator Kaminsky gave us a number of improper prosecutions that have occurred. I forget what that number was, but my point is this. One miscarriage of justice is too much, too many, when we're dealing with people's life and liberty. And no one ought to be above the law, especially, quite frankly, our prosecutors. Because nowhere is the old power of the king and the queen and the pharaoh and the dictator still in existence when it comes to prosecutors' offices. Nowhere is the power of the state more likely to be abused than in the office of prosecutors. And why? Because they have the power over your freedom. They can take everything you have away from you. And we have the best system on earth, no doubt, but every so often, someone comes along and abuses the system. My colleagues in this chamber, you know that I threw every ounce of my fiber into the Raise the Age debate last year. I did so because I believe to my core that we have an opportunity with young people that we might not have later on. And I listened to the debate, and I heard time and time again from my colleagues across the aisle that our system is corrupt, that it is inherently abusive, that there are people, especially people of color, who are not treated fairly in our system, and that there are human beings in jail who don't belong in jail. And that only happens, by the way, through prosecutorial misconduct. It's the only way an innocent person ultimately ends up in jail, prosecutorial misconduct. Now, again, there are very few cases like that, but one is too many. And I listened to Senator Kaminsky, and if the things that he said about this bill were true in terms of what it would do to prosecutors, I would be disturbed, and I could not support it. All we're saying here is that when you assume the awesome power as a prosecutor in this state, that you need to apply the laws of the land fairly and without discrimination and without prejudice. And by the way, if you do your job properly the way you ought to and the way the majority of prosecutors do, you have nothing to be worried about and nothing to be concerned about. This will do nothing to prevent you from doing justice. But as Senator DeFrancisco said, it will send a message to those who might otherwise be tempted to do the political thing or the prejudicial thing or the discriminatory thing, and perhaps this legislation will prevent that from happening. And so to Senator DeFrancisco, I thank you. Again, for me, it is sad that I am standing here talking about the need for this legislation, but I think in today's day and age, with the craziness that surrounds us, with the hyper-politicalization, that the day has come. Mr. President, I'm in support of this legislation.
Senator Bonasack.
This discussion has been excellent on this issue. Senator Kaminsky, I think you spoke eloquently of what would happen with district attorneys and defendants coming forward as a former prosecutor. Senator DeFrancisco, Senator Lanza, I thank you for the courage that this bill is on the floor. I thank you for your passion, Senator Sanders. When did you ever think that law and order with the Republican Conference, which we embrace, that you would see a bill like this on the floor? We have a reputation to embrace law enforcement, to embrace DAs. That's who we've been for so long. But times are changing. Times are changing. And how many times have I heard the treatment to an African American in the justice system, that there's two tiers of justice, one for the poor man and one for the rich man. Many a times. And as Senator Lanza said, we have a few bad apples in the DA's office. They're all my friends, by the way, in the four counties that I represent. But when I say the winds are changing, politics, political ambition has taken over in all aspects, in all areas of professionalism. But in every area of professionalism, doctors, lawyers, accountants, police officers, you got to be accountable if you've done something wrong to, I'll just call it, an integrity board that watches over these areas, but not prosecutors. So there's a loophole in the system. And what disturbs me is if there is an indictment, a political indictment, it won't be called that, it'll be called something else, but it is a political indictment. whether it's the color of someone's skin, whether it's your political philosophy, whether I have blind ambition as a prosecutor to become a governor, to become a U.S. Attorney General, to become a judge. I want a good track record, I want publicity, and I'm going to pick high-profile cases. Now, DAs, in my judgment, never used to act that way. But we're seeing it more and more. We're seeing people go to jail and then exonerated because of DNA. And they never get their life back. I agree with you. The taxpayers will pay that person for that loss, but they will never truly compensate them for the loss. And that DA who might have done that, no repercussions, no accountability. It's often been said that a prosecutor can indict a ham sandwich if they want. And I believe that to be true. I believe that to be true to this day. So it pains me to have to do this because I know the few bad apples and the wind of political animals or political professionals, especially in the prosecutor's area, we're seeing more and more cases of injustice. So I'm going to support this bill. It's bittersweet for me, but I think the time has come that everybody has to be accountable, even our good friend prosecutors, because the damage they may do to 2% of the people, and they make good decisions for the 98% of the people, it's too harmful. The damage is too brutal. The whole justice system comes under question because of the 2% bad discretion by prosecutors doing things for the wrong reason. And they have to be accountable. And I will end my remarks by saying a good, decent prosecutor, and most of them throughout the state are, will never have to worry about this legislation because they know they're always doing the right thing like legislators do when they stand here and always under scrutiny. If you're always doing the right thing, you never have to watch your back. I vote yes. Thank you, Mr. President.
Mary Boyle.
Mr. President, on the bill, I'd first like to thank Senator DeFrancisco for his champion of this legislation. I think it's long overdue. As my colleagues have said, I believe the vast, vast, vast majority of prosecutors are good, honest, hardworking people in the state of New York. But there are some bad apples. I talk about Suffolk County, where I'm from. Recently, an assistant district attorney was fired in the middle of a murder trial. They found out he was withholding evidence. Come to find out, he had five other murder trials, which the cases were dismissed. I'm not talking about speeding tickets, murder trials. Five murder cases dismissed because of the misconduct of this assistant district attorney. This assistant district attorney was fired by our district attorney at the time, who, by the way, is now under federal criminal prosecution himself. What I see also and worries me a lot was, as was said, the political aspect of this. I see some prosecutors, who are looking for the headline. They find somebody, a low-level person in the town, who's doing the wrong thing, taking bribes, an outside company, a businessman, giving bribes, instead of saying, you guys are doing the wrong thing. We're going to prosecute you, going to jail, and throw away the key. No, they say, we got to get a headline. That's not going to get us on the front of the newspaper. So we're going to go after the politician, who is the boss, and twitch themselves into pretzels to go after these elected officials, because that's going to be on the cover of the newspaper, spending millions of dollars and years of disruption in the town and in the county. As far as the discovery was reformed, Senator Kaminsky, thank you for your comments. I know you're passionate about this issue. Mentioned discovery reform as a way of modifying this or helping the situation. Well, that's funny because earlier this year I was visited by district attorneys who are against discovery reform. That may not be the answer that we're going to get across the finish line. We all agree we need to do the right thing and fix the system. It does have flaws. The vast majority are good prosecutors, we got to root out the evil ones. And I would quote Martin Luther King, "An injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere." I strongly support this bill and vote aye.
Is there any other senator that wishes to be heard? Senator Hoylman?
Mr. President, would the sponsor yield for a couple of questions?
Senator Francisco, do you yield?
Yes.
Senator yields.
To you, Mr. President. What are the specific conditions for a complainant before this commission?
Well, it sets it forth in the bill that it's basically an allegation that the prosecutor is not following the law and guilty of misconduct. Then the commission then reviews it, or a panel of three appointed by the commission reviews the allegation. If there's no proof of that, then the case is not proven and it's over.
Would this sponsor continue to yield?
Yes.
Through you, Mr. President, is there any burden of proof for complainants?
By the preponderance of the evidence. It's the same burden of proof with judges.
I didn't see that in the bill, but would this sponsor continue to yield? Is there any requirement that allegations be sworn under oath by complainants?
The commission is going to set forth the rules, but that is what's done in the Judicial Conduct Commission, and that's the same format.
Sponsor continue to yield. For the record, there is no requirement that allegations be sworn under oath. Who would have standing to file a complaint?
Well, the people that have standing are those that are alleged to have been the victims of the misconduct.
Sponsor continue to yield. The way I read it, anyone would have standing. Do you can you point to the bill that suggests otherwise?
No, but as I keep repeating, this is the same law that set into motion the same wording of the law that had set in motion the Judicial Conduct Committee, and the same rules that they have adopted, I would most likely believe, I believe would be the rules adopted by this commission as well, since they have worked.
Would this sponsor continue to yield? So as the law is currently written, not speculating as to what may be issued in regulations moving forward, if a investigation was undertaken by a district attorney, a third party with no connection to the investigation, member of the public or the press, or a political ally could file a complaint. Is that correct?
It doesn't,
as the bill is currently written?
It doesn't limit anyone from filing a complaint. It is written broadly, like the Judicial Conduct Commission, so that they could go through. What happens in the Judicial Conduct Commission is basically whatever the complaints are, they'll review a slew of complaints. Many of them don't have any basis, and they deny them. It's the point is to provide this vehicle. This is not a criminal case where your liberty is at, where you're at liberty. Your liberty is at stake by what is going to happen. That's what the prosecution case is before a judge. This is a place for a complaint, just like a grievance complaint, but an independent body that rather than the grievance committee reviewing the DA.
Sponsor continue to yield?
Sponsor yields.
So, let's say a district attorney has launched an investigation of one of our colleagues. One of our other colleagues gets wind of the fact that this is underway, a corruption investigation. Could, in theory, our colleague or his or her political ally then file a complaint and initiate an investigation of the investigators?
If there is a basis for it. This isn't just a complaint because the charge has been brought. The Prosecutorial Conduct Commission is going to review that complaint because somebody doesn't think it should have been brought. These are cases where there's misconduct in the course of the prosecutor's duty. 90% of these things deal with failing to provide exculpatory material. So anybody can say anything about anybody, as we all know as elected officials, but that's the point of the group that's going to review these allegations. There has to be a basis for them, a basis on misconduct. It'd be almost impossible to prove a case that the prosecution should have been brought, because the prosecutor has broad discretion under the law. But if in reviewing that case and in pursuing the case, he violates the rules that he's supposed to abide by, those are the cases that will be the ones that are the focus of this commission.
Would the sponsor continue? Yield. Through you, Mr. President. If the complainant charges baseless and unfounded charges, what are the consequences for the complainant?
Well, the complainant, there are no consequences. There are no consequences under this bill. If it's a sworn statement and they lied in the sworn statement, there's a criminal charge that could be brought against them. But this is a vehicle for the general public to have a prosecutor's conduct reviewed.
On the bill, Mr. President. We just heard, Mr. President, that if a complainant brings charges, he or she does not have to have any direct connection to the investigation or case being pursued by the district attorney. He or she doesn't have to have any standing. He or she can, let's be real, be simply a political crony, a supporter of, let's just say, a state senator who's being investigated by a district attorney. And we have provided a vehicle to totally upend that investigation through this legislation. I understand and feel very deeply for the concerns expressed by my colleagues about the need for criminal justice reform, particularly as it impacts our minority communities, including mine. But I believe this bill is providing a very suspicious cover for bad actions and bad actors in our state legislature. We are politicizing the investigatory process. We are appointing a board, a commission, made up entirely, nearly, of appointees by the governor, Senate Majority Leader, Senate Minority Leader, the Speaker, the Assembly Minority Leader. And we are suggesting that this legislation will find a fair and depoliticized outcome when it comes to investigating the actions of other elected officials, our district attorneys. I don't think so. I'm fearful that this will be viewed by the public as decommissioning Moreland Part 2. And I think that we need to take a more considered approach toward rectifying the abuses, some of which, of course, do exist on behalf of district attorneys, but certainly not through a highly politicized nature that, in fact, results in providing cover for those of us who sit in this chamber. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Hoylman. Is there any other senator that wishes to be heard or speak? Senator Kaminsky, you want to speak now or to explain your vote? You're eligible to speak. This is your second time, and this would be the last opportunity. Senator Kaminsky.
Thank you. I'll be very brief.
On the bill?
On the bill.
Senator Kaminsky, on the bill.
All my colleagues, but especially across the aisle, you can vote for this for any reason you want, but please don't vote for it for the view that if you're a good prosecutor, you have nothing to worry about. You have a lot to worry about. This will be a drain on your time, your resources, your reputation, and the office's ability to do justice without fear or favor, because there will be a tribunal you will be hauled in front of on every single case. Thank you.
Is there any other senator that wishes to be heard? Seeing none, I will allow Senator DeFrancisco, as the sponsor of the bill, to close debate. Senator DeFrancisco.
Thank you, and I appreciate the debate, and it's nice to see a bipartisan debate in this chambers based upon a piece of legislation that I think was worked on, I know was worked on for a long period of time, and I think is well thought out. The first, just a couple of responses, and that's all I want to do. There's been talk about discovery reform. I believe that that should happen. But if you're a prosecutor who is already under the existing rules, not providing exculpatory material, you can write the best rule in the world in a discovery reform. That same prosecutor, if he or she is inclined to, is going to violate that rule as well. So even with discovery reform, we need a bill like this. Secondly, the concept of that this is some kind of cynical attempt to try to protect political people by filing complaints in this commission is, well, I remember what the prayer was yesterday. I'll think good thoughts. I'll say good things. I won't say what I really want to say. I think is just not a right analysis of this bill, because all you can do is bring a complaint that there was misconduct, some breach of duty, not by a charge being brought. That's not a breach of duty. If you're talking about while he's conducting his duties that there's a breach of conduct. And it reminds me, 2 years ago, when this bill was maybe 3 years ago, I can't even remember anymore. But I know I started working on this bill before the Moreland Commission, before MC. It's like BCMC. The fact of the matter is I wasn't even thinking about political cases when I drafted this, the first iteration of this bill. I was thinking about the people that most are talking about here that had evidence withheld against that they should have gotten and spent many, many years in jail. And this is sort of a complaint. And 2 or 3 years ago, my prosecutor told the newspaper that this was simply an effort on my behalf to strike back at the Moreland Commission, which irritated me to no end, about as much as I'm irritated today by being accused of that same motive. It's just not correct. So I understand people have differences of opinion here. Prosecutors should prosecute. They should be supported by everyone. But when a bad prosecutor does something that results in somebody losing their liberty, there's got to be a remedy. There is not a remedy now. This is the remedy. It's not the perfect bill. I don't know how to do that. All I know is, and I'm not smart enough to come up with some perfect bill. So what I did, I looked at a bill that's been a law that we've worked with since the 1970s, the Judicial Conduct Commission. And all of the horrible things that we're talking about today that could happen have not happened. Good things have happened since the Judicial Conduct Commission. So I would urge all of you to please support this bill. It's an important bill, and I appreciate the debate, and I thank the leader for allowing us to put this bill on the floor today for an open debate and giving everybody the opportunity to vote on it. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator DeFrancisco. Debate is closed. The Secretary will ring the bell. Secretary will read the last section. We have a number of people that have requested explanation of votes. I'm going to ask that you all comply with the Senate rules and please stay within a two-minute explanation. Read the last section.
Section 3 of this act should take effect on the 1st of January.
Senator Flanagan.
Call the roll.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousin, Jung.
Senator, explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. This has been fantastic. And every now and then, I think this applies to all of us. It makes me proud to be a public servant, to sit in this room and actually deliberate and have really substantive conversations on important issues of public policy. So I often think that that is lost sometimes when the public hears about what goes on in Albany or not. They should look at a tape like this and realize we actually do a lot of very good things. I want to join the remarks of Senator DeFrancisco on a couple of different levels, not the least of which is the comparison to the conduct on Judicial Commission. We're not breaking new ground here. We're basically adding a new layer to what is a system that's been in place for a very long time that has worked well. And Senator DeFrancisco is correct. The world did not come to an end when that came into being many years ago. And on top of that, you know, I was listening to the debate, talk about lots and lots of good prosecutors. We talk about good elected officials. We talk about good people and bad people. For me, philosophically, when we come into this chamber, we're not really making laws for the good people. When you look at the environment, we're not making a law for someone who goes and does the beach cleanup. We make a law for the guy who does the illegal dumping. When there's a rogue doctor who's giving out prescriptions, we're not making it for the candy striper or the volunteer who's there in a hospital. So I think consistently we have a method of operation here where, frankly, we have to make laws to protect the good people from the bad people. And if that is going to apply to prosecutors, and I think it should, then so be it. Lastly, using the vernacular, sometimes he's Johnny D. Sometimes he's DeFran. Today I want to make it really clear. Today he's Senator John DeFrancisco. Now I'm going to tell you something, and I'm going to tell you with great clarity. He and I have had many, many conversations on this bill for years. I know where his head was at in the beginning. I know where it was in the process. I know where it is now. That's nothing to do with anything other than Senator DeFrancisco, a man with a wealth of experience, trying to do the right thing by the public. I am so blessed and happy to call on my colleague, and I'm going to, if I could vote yes twice, I would do it in a second. Mr. President, thank you. I vote in the affirmative.
Senator Flanagan in the affirmative. Senator Bonasek to explain his vote.
Real brief. Senator Comiskey, I think you're right. I think there will be more harassment, more aggravation for DAs if this becomes law. But I do believe it'll be short term. I do believe that a lot of this stuff, with the passage of time, these false claims will go away. And just maybe, having this commission in place, maybe a bad actor prosecutor will not do a bad indictment, and we would have accomplished a lot if that happens. I vote yes. Thank
Senator
you,
Bonasek,
Mr. President.
Affirmative. Senator Krueger to explain her vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. So it's true, it was a bipartisan debate. It was probably one of the better debates I've seen on the floor of this House in the 16 years I've been here. It's a critically important issue we take on. It's probably not a perfect bill, but you know what? As many of my colleagues said, we can do this bill today, and we can chapter amendment changes to make it even better in the future. There are so many people who have nowhere to turn at this point in time that I feel very proud that I am voting yes on this bill today. Thank you, Mr. President.
Senator Krueger in the affirmative. Senator Sanders to explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. I came here to give the position of the people in my district, and with, I just want to read some of the names of the people so that they will have a voice as I vote. Baba Ali Amin, Karim Bellamy, Ricardo Benitez, Lazario Burt, Carlos Cardenas, Napoleon Cardenas, Lambert Charles, Ronald Dudley, Fancy Figueroa, Goose, Gerald Harris, Lee Long, I'm trying to do this fast, Terrence Mason, Todd McCord, Julia Negron, Lamar Palmer, Racky Ramchair, Derek Redd, Arthur Stewart, Clinton Turner, I could go on. These are some of the people who have been wrongfully convicted from Queens, and today at least they had their voices mentioned. This is not a perfect bill. I look forward to working on it in the future to ensure that if it does anything negative to prosecutors, that we can find a way to remedy that. But those people deserve their voices heard too. And I vote yes on behalf of them.
Senator Sanders in the affirmative. Senator Savino to explain her vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. You know, I've been in the Senate now 14 years, and I've been on the Judiciary Committee, I think, every year that I've been here. And I can remember debating in the Judiciary Committee with various members over the years about this bill. We even debated it this morning, discussing it amongst ourselves. And I actually thought I knew what I was going to do. I'd always voted against it because of the very compelling arguments that Senator Kaminsky has made about it and some of the other members who have served as DAs. And I still think his arguments are very compelling, and they're issues that we have to make sure we correct. But after listening to this bipartisan debate that Senator Flanagan referenced, and listening to some of you who have been practicing prosecutors, those of you who are practitioners of the law, I find myself for the first time changing my vote. I thought I knew what I was going to do when I walked in the room. I was going to vote no. But now, after listening to the passion, people, and reminding us what we're really supposed to be doing here, which is about providing fairness to our constituents everywhere. And if this may not be the perfect bill, I think Senator Kaminsky's right. I think we have to take a crack at it next year, maybe improve it. But I think we have to strike a blow for fairness for people who don't feel that they have a fair shake in our court system. I vote in the affirmative, Mr. President.
Senator Savino to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Bailey to explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'll be very brief. The journey of 1,000 miles begins with yet a single step, and this is that step. It is not perfect. I don't want to, you know, continue to say everything that's been said, but this was an enlightening debate, and we should have more of it. The greatest thing about democracy can be dissent, because we need to hear things that are outside of our echo chamber, and we need to talk about issues that we're not comfortable with. This is not a comfortable conversation. We weren't sent to Albany to be comfortable. We were sent to Albany to impact the lives of 300,000 representatives plus in our district every single day. That's what I come to work for. And yes, I look forward to a more robust discussion of this and many other substantive issues in criminal justice. Senator DeFrancisco said, once again, discovery reform, we should do it. This single step today is something that I'm proud to stand with my colleagues in voting aye for, Mr. President, and I thank you for your time, and I thank all my colleagues for the discourse on this matter. I vote aye, Mr. President.
Senator Bailey, to be recorded in the affirmative, announce the results.
Relation to calendar number 1783, those recorded the negative of Senators Addabbo, Gallivan, Griffo, Hoylman, Kaminsky, O'Mara, Ranzenhofer, Ritchie, Seward, and Tedisco, absent from voting.
Also Senator Marchion and Young.
Also in the negative are Senators Marchion and Young, absent from voting. Senators DeLon, Felder, and Murphy. Ayes 44, nays 12.
Bill is passed. Francisco.
Can we now take up the non-controversial reading of the active calendar, please?
Will we begin non-controversial reading of today's active list, original active list calendar. Calendar number 128, the Secretary will read.
Calendar number 128 by Senator Avella, Senate Print 1409, an act to amend the Family Court Act.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect on the 30th.
Go ahead.
This act should take effect on the 30th day.
Call and roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 660 by Senator Hoylman, Senate Print 7780, an act relating to granting.
There's a home rule message present at the desk. Secretary will read the last section.
Section 3, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 1105 by Senator Ranzanoff for Senate Print 6686, an act to amend the state finance law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect on the 180th day.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1159 by Senator Gallivan, Senate Print 4252B, an act authorized.
Read the last section.
Section 3, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1167 by Senator Phillips, Senate Print 8284, an act amending the Retirement Social Security Law.
There's a home rule message present at the desk. Secretary will read the last section.
Section 4, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1168 by Senator Phillips, Senate Print 8293, an act amending the Retirement Social Security Law.
There's a home rule message present at the desk. Secretary will read the last section.
Section 4, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1325 by Member of the Assembly Carroll, Assembly Print 10365, an act to amend Chapter 363 of the laws of 2010.
Last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1349 by Senator Lanza, Senate Print 8230, an act amending executive law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill passes.
Calendar number 1359 by Senator Young, Senate Print 446, an act to amend the mental hygiene law.
Read the last section.
Section 17, this act should take effect on the 30th day.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young.
Kruger to explain. Senator Kruger to explain her vote.
So we just had a robust debate on a different bill involving the court system and what can happen. In this bill, we expand the definition of who can be involuntarily hospitalized. The law is already clear. If you're going to be at risk of doing harm to yourself or others, you can be involuntarily, against your will, put into a hospital. I feel that the expansion of the law is too broad in this bill and opens us up to the risk of people based on behaving in ways that don't make us comfortable, translating into their being involuntarily hospitalized. So I do think when we're going to take away someone's freedom and liberty, whether it's to put them in a prison or in a hospital, we need to make sure our standards are extremely high for that. And so I must vote no, Mr. President.
Senator Kruger to be recorded in the negative. Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 1359, those recorded in the negative are Senators Alcantara, Bailey, Benjamin, Brooks, Comrie, Hoylman, Kaminsky, Mayer, Montgomery, Parker, Persaud, Rivera, and Sanders.
Kavanaugh.
Also Senator Kavanaugh. Ayes 45, nays 14.
The bill passes.
Calendar number 1371 by Member of the Assembly, People Stokes, Assembly Print 8156, an act to amend the state finance law.
The last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1448 by Senator Felder, Senate Print 2106C, an act to amend the education law.
Last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill passes.
Calendar number 1474 by Senator Akshar, Senate Print 8431, an act to amend the correction law.
Last section.
Section 3, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill passes.
Calendar number 1718 by Senator Krueger, Senate Print 6379, enact amend the education law.
Last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Senator DeFrancisco, that completes the non... the bill is passed, and that completes the non-controversial reading of the active list originally before the House.
Can we go back to motions and resolutions, please?
Will we return to motions and resolutions?
I wish to call up Senator LaBelle's bill, print 6278, recalled from the Assembly, which is now at the desk.
Secretary will read.
Calendar number 1185 by Senator LaBelle, Senate Print 6278, enacted in Chapter 699 of the laws of 1947.
I now move to reconsider the vote by which the bill was passed.
Call the roll on reconsideration.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
I now offer the following amendments.
The amendments are received.
Now can we take up the non-controversial reading of the balance of Supplemental Calendar 55A, please?
Secretary will begin reading Senate Supplemental Calendar 55A with calendar number 1781.
Calendar number 1781 by Member of the Assembly of Buckwall, December 7819A, enact amend the state finance law.
Last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect on the 60th day.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1782 by Senator Golden, Senate Print 1862A, enact amend the civil service law.
Last section.
Section 4, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill passes.
Calendar number 1784 by Senator Griffo, Senate Print 2538A, enact amend the vehicle and traffic law.
Last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill passes.
Calendar number 1785 by Senator DeFrancisco, Senate Print 3502, enact amend the state law.
Last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young.
Senator Krueger to explain her vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. I will vote for this bill, but for the record, there are much more attractive amphibians in New York State. There's quite a few newts I looked up that are far more interesting, some of them spotty, some of them sticky. So I didn't think we needed another debate today on amphibians, and I will vote yes, but I think we could have been a little more creative. Thank you, Mr. President.
Perhaps if you kissed a frog, they may become a prince or princess. Yeah. Senator Krueger in the affirmative. Senator Hoylman to explain his. Oh, Senator Hoylman's in a negative. Senator Sanders to explain his vote.
I think it is only fitting that the sponsor is giving this to us. I think that if anyone can convince us that this worthy animal, no, it was amphibian should represent the greatness of New York, it is a sponsor. So in that spirit, I agree with him, and I vote yes.
Senator Sanders to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator DeFrancisco without a frog in his throat.
Well. Just to remind everyone, there was a fourth grade class in my district that was studying amphibians and found out that there was no state amphibian. And as an exercise in government, and that's the only reason I'm doing this, they lobbied me, they wrote me, they came to Albany, they came to New York, and here now they can see that government does work. Thank you.
Senator DeFrancisco, the affirmative, announce the results.
In relation to calendar 1785, those recorded in the negative are Senators Giannaris, Hoylman, and Kennedy. Ayes 56, nays 3.
Bill passes.
Calendar number 1786 by Senator Lanza, Senate Print 3541, enacted amend the public health law.
Last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect immediately.
Call roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill passes.
Calendar number 1787 by Member of the Assembly Samota, Assembly Print 2451, enact amend the public service law.
Last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Passes.
Calendar number 1788 by Member of the Assembly People Stokes, Assembly Print 2788B, enact amend the tax law.
Last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill passes.
Calendar number 1789 by Senator DeFrancisco, Senate Print 5631B, enact amended vehicle and traffic law.
Last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect on the 1st of November.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1790 by Member of the Assembly Abate, Assembly Print 6991. Enact amend Chapter 154 of the laws of 1921.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act to take effect upon enactment into law by the state of New Jersey.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill passes.
Calendar number 1791 by Senator O'Mara, Senate Print 6475A. Enact to direct.
Last section.
Section 6, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill passes.
Calendar number 1792 by Senator Ranzenhofer, Senate Print 6622A, enact amendment to general municipal law.
Last section.
Section 4, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 58, nays 1. Senator Krueger recorded in the negative.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1793 by Senator Amador, Senate Print 6666, enact amend the workers' compensation law.
Last section.
Section 4, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1794 by Senator Persaud, Senate Print 7018, enact amend the public service law.
Last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect on the 120th day.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill passes.
Calendar number 1795 by Senator Ranzenhofer, Senate Print 7397A, enact amend the tax law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect April 1, 2019.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young.
Results.
Relation to calendar 1795, those recorded in the negative are Senators Addabbo, Bailey, Brooks, Hoylman, Kavanaugh, Krueger, Mayer, and Sanders. Ayes 51, nays 8.
Bill passes.
Calendar number 1796 by Senator O'Mara, Senate Print 7561A, enact amend the tax law.
Last section.
Section 4, this act should take effect immediately.
Call roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young.
Results.
In relation to calendar 1796, those recorded in the negative are Senators Hoylman, Kavanaugh, Krueger, and Rivera. Ayes 55, nays 4.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 17.
It's getting a little noisy in the chamber. Secretary will continue.
Calendar number 1797 by Senator Ranzenhofer, Senate Print 7815, act amend the tax law.
Call roll.
Section 2, this act should take effect immediately.
Call roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1798 by Member of the Assembly Fahey, Assembly Print 10,058, enact amend Chapter 454 of the laws of 2010.
There's a home rule message present at the desk. The Secretary will read the last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1799 by Member of the Assembly Jaffe, Assembly Print 9729, enact amend the real property tax
last
law.
Last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill passes.
Calendar number 1800 by Senator Kaminsky, Senate Print 8127, an act authorizing.
Last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 58, nays 1. Senator Bonasek recorded in the negative.
Bill passes.
Calendar number 1801 by Senator Addabbo, Senate Print 8193, enacting amending the environmental conservation law.
Last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 57, nays 2, Senators Griffo and Lanza recorded in the negative.
Bill's passed.
Calendar number 1802 by Senator Murphy, Senate Print 8568, enact amending the Alcoholic Beverage Control Law.
Last section.
Section 27, the statute should take effect on the 90th day.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill passes.
Calendar number 1803 by Senator LaValle, Senate Print 8639C, enact amending the Education Law.
Last section.
Section 6, the statute should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill passes.
Calendar number 1804 by Member of the Assembly Nolan, Assembly Print 381, enact amend the education law.
Last section.
Section 2, the statute take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill passes.
Calendar number 1805 by Senator Ort, Senate Print 8769, enact amend the mental hygiene law.
Last section.
Section 2, the statute take effect on the 180th day.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
The bill passes.
Calendar number 1806 by Senator Felder.
Lay the bill aside for the day.
Calendar number 1807 by Senator Seward, Senate Print 8830, enact amend the Agriculture and Markets Law.
Last section.
Section 4, the statute should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill passes.
Calendar number 1808 by Member of the Assembly of Santa Barbara. Assembly
Santa
Print
Barbara.
9.
Santa Barbara.
You want to say it? Assembly Print 9868A, enact amend the public health law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, the statute should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Stewart, Cousins, Young. Ayes 59.
Bill's passed. Senator DeFrancisco, that completes the non-controversial reading of the Senate Supplemental Calendar 55A.
I would just like to take a moment to recognize the birthday of one of our very senior members, Senator John Bonasek.
Happy birthday, Senator Bonasek. The odds are good that you'll continue for a long time. Congratulations.
There is a supplemental active list with one bill on it, calendar 1446 by Senator Felder, and I'd like to lay that bill aside for the day.
That bill will be laid aside for the day.
And can we turn to motions and resolutions?
Return to motions and resolutions.
I'd like to call up Senator LaValle's bill, print 6278, recall from the Assembly, which is now at the desk. Or did we do this?
We did it.
We did it. It was under my papers. So I guess I should say, never mind. Is there any further business at the desk?
There is no further business at the desk.
In that case, I move to adjourn until Monday, June 18th at 1 p.m. 1 p.m., intervening days being legislative days.
On motion, the Senate will stand adjourned until Monday, June 18th at 1 p.m., intervening days being legislative days. The Senate is adjourned.